Good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Because we're going to have a lively discussion. So, good afternoon, everybody.
Good afternoon.
Much better. Thank you for joining us this afternoon for the session on State of Good Repair and Transit Asset Management. My name is Diana Mendez, and I will be the moderator for this session. And we have a fantastic panel that covers the whole gamut of issues around state of good repair and transit asset management from policy to implementation. So I look forward to their presentations, and I know you will enjoy them as well. Just a little bit of housekeeping. There are some hot pink sheets over there next to the, is that a water cooler?
Or?
Yes, okay, next to the water cooler. And so for those of you who need AIA credits or AICP continuing education credits, please sign those sheets. So as we've heard today at lunch, and as we've been talking about in the industry for several years now, state of good repair is at the forefront of everybody's mind. Well, that's interesting. Is that somebody's ringtone? Maybe I should say, turn your cell phones off. And so our panel today is going to focus on the challenges and opportunities associated with bringing systems into a state of good repair and implementing transit asset management programs while meeting federal requirements and keeping their systems operating. So how we're going to work things today is I'm going to introduce all of the speakers at once. Then they're going to go through their presentation, and we're going to hold questions and answers until the end of the presentation because we have a lot of different topics that we're covering, and so we'll have a more robust discussion with the benefit of all of the information associated with our panelists. So first, we're going to hear from two presenters who are going to do sort of a bigger policy picture, one from the owner-operator side and one from the federal side. So our first speaker will be Michael McLaughlin, and he is the Deputy Chief of Staff at the Chicago Transit Authority. He earned an undergraduate degree in history and political science from the University of Iowa, and a master's in public affairs from Indiana University. Okay. One more time. Please turn off your cell phones, beepers, iPads, whatever might chirp. He got a master's in public affairs from Indiana University. And prior to working at CTA, Michael worked on Capitol Hill for 12 years as a senior House and Senate transportation aide to three different members of Congress. Michael's primary role at CTA is to help President Dorval Carter oversee the infrastructure, planning, finance, government relations, and media departments at CTA. So he has no life, but welcome him anyway. I'm going to go ahead and introduce everybody. Robert J. Tusillo, our second speaker, who will present the federal perspective, is the Associate Administrator for Budget and Policy and the Chief Financial Officer at the Federal Transit Administration. He oversees an office responsible for budget, accounting, financial systems, policy development, strategic planning, and data analysis. His office is the FTA lead office for transit asset management and transit-oriented development technical assistance, and also works on innovative financing, including joint development, value capture, and public-private partnerships. Bob is a graduate of the University of Hartford, Virginia Tech, and the executive development program at the JF Kennedy School of Government at Harvard University. So we have no people who don't make any little plans up here, and another overachiever. Welcome, Bob. Next, we'll be hearing from Mike Nabhan, and he's going to take us through some of the issues associated with data and decision-making and asset management. And Mike is the Asset Management Report Developer for the Regional Transportation District in Denver, Colorado. RTD is a multimodal agency serving a population of over 2.8 million people across 2,300 square miles. Prior to the transit industry, Mike's experience was centered around financial asset management, both from an advisory standpoint as well as portfolio management. Mike graduated from the University of Denver with a finance degree and has experience programming through side projects. As a natural extension of these two competencies, Mike works as a business intelligence developer for the RTD Asset Management and State of Good Repair program, combining financial expertise with quantitative analysis of operations and maintenance procedures. So, welcome our techie, Mike. Okay, Bernadette Lambert will speak next, and she's going to focus on bringing transportation assets into a state of good repair from the perspective of the importance of boundary and title determinations. And Bernadette has been providing capital project support to the San Francisco Bay Area Rapid Transit District for 10 years and is currently a program manager in BART's Planning, Development, and Construction Department. She holds a master's degree in transportation management and is a licensed attorney and real estate broker, as well as being a certified project management professional. Bernadette also is past president and international director of Chapter 2 of the International Right-of-Way Association and is a fellow at the Eno Center for Transportation. So she brings a diverse perspective, that of an attorney as well as a planner. So welcome, Bernadette. And rounding out our panel today is Steve Meyer, and he's going to be focusing on using performance metrics as a tool in asset management, so sort of pulling it all together and what does all this data and technical analysis mean. Steve is the Chief Development Officer for the Utah Transit Authority, where he leads the Capital Development Department. His responsibilities include transit-oriented development, major project development, environmental study and management, real estate, property management, asset management, facilities maintenance, and construction management. I mean, you don't have a life either. It's pretty 24/7. Steve has been with UTA for over 14 years, and prior to his current position, he was the project manager for the design and construction of UTA's Front Runner commuter rail projects. So, welcome, Steve. So with that, for a big picture perspective from a major transit operator, let's hear from Michael.
Thank you. Thanks, Diana. Diana could probably give this presentation. Her firm is actually our program manager at CTA, so she could have called on a few people who work for us to get more in depth. So I'll say right up front, I'm not the technical person on State of Good Repair Transit Asset Management. If you want to talk to those people, go to the FTA's roundtable, which I think is happening next month. Mm-hmm. We have some, Leah Mooney and some others are going to that roundtable, mm-hmm. and they'll get more on the technical side. I'll touch on it a little bit here. Our State of Good Repair Backlog or Transit Asset Management. I really don't need to, because if you're just at the plenary session, Dorval Carter, my president, said it all, and you know, if you know anything about job security, you don't follow your president because they're 10 times better than you. But here I go anyway. Diana mentioned I worked in Capitol Hill, and my background for me is State of Good Repair kind of started on when I was working for Senator Durbin in 2005 to 2007. Here are my key points. Obviously, State of Good Repair is a growing concern. It could be the theme of the conference if we wanted to. It was the theme of the plenary session. But if I'm going to have one takeaway from today, it is that the State of Good Repair rules and regs and the transit asset management rules and regs did not just come on down from on high from the FTA just because they wanted it to. It came because transit agencies, members of Congress, worked with the FTA quite a few years ago mm-hmm. to come out with some reports that kind of frame the issue, and then some of that language got into MAP 21 right. And further allowed the FTA to continue what they already knew they need to be done, but in many ways the grassroots advocacy from the transit agencies and the members of Congress. When I worked for Senator Durbin, we had a blue line incident in Chicago in the subway in 2006, and I was his transportation person. He came to me and said, these transit agencies, CTA, Metro, all around the country are the old ones need some money. What can we do? So we started thinking about it, and I left before the request went up to a couple months before the request went up to FTA for a rail mod, what ended up becoming a rail mod report. I'm not going to read everything on these slides. If you want to talk to me later, we can. But this is just more or less to help me remember what I need to say. But here's the rail mod report. The Senate in 2007, like I said, had something in the appropriations bill and sent a formal letter to FTA asking them to study the to conduct a study to determine the infrastructure needs of our country's largest rail systems. Notice, other than Durbin, you also had President Obama, right, and then Senator Hillary Clinton on the letter. In addition to, there's a bipartisan letter. There's Democrats and Republicans on it, mostly from the Northeast and the Midwest. And they came out with a 2009 rail mod study. I don't know if Rich Steinman's around here, but Rich, I know he went up to the Hill and met with a lot of the large transit agencies, what has become the Metropolitan Rail Discussion Group, New York, Philly, Chicago, Boston, the old legacy systems, Cleveland. Rich and others came up to Capitol Hill and explained what was in the report as it was being released. It found a $50 billion backlog just from those seven transit agencies. CTA at that time had a $10 billion backlog. It's $13 billion now. And we've spent, as Dorval said, we've already spent $5 billion. So that shows you, if you don't start whittling it down, it grows and grows, even if you do whittle it down. But this was one of the reports that actually put together State of Grid Repair and Transit Asset Management. It recommended the increased funding for State of Grid Repair and FDA technical assistance for transit asset management. So there's, I think, four recommendations, and those were two of them. And subsequent reports that came out in a couple years later went up to $77 billion, then I think it's $86 billion was the latest figure. Mm-hmm. And that's a couple years ago, so we can imagine it might even be probably a little higher now. Here are the seven agencies. As you can see, they cover 80% of all rail transit riders. That's a figure from back in 2009 or so. So that might be a little off, but still gives you order of magnitude. Then the stimulus bill came around, which was very helpful, as those of us who work in transit agencies can all attest. In 2009, gave a really big boost of funding when we really needed it. At the same time, Safety Lou was expiring. So there was a lot of advocacy. The advocacy continued. It didn't just stop with asking FTA to put out some reports. It continued amongst a whole bunch of agencies to go lobby members of Congress and congressional staff for increased data group repair funding. At the same time, FTA was started their roundtables, their FTA roundtables. And they also started renaming the bus and bus facilities grants, some of them as state of grid repair grants. So this isn't just a rail issue, even though rail obviously is much more capital intensive. I want to say that the ratio might be 8-2 or something like that, 9-1 amongst the state of grid repair of rail versus bus. But rail is very important. The CTA, we carry more riders versus bus than we do rail. And some of our bus facilities are pre-World War II. They need a lot of work, as do our buses. And also CTA did, there are also some transit asset management grants that went out, I think, in 2010 and 2012. At least that's when CTA got them. I don't remember the years that we didn't receive the funding. And some of these pictures, actually, the bottom picture, I took this screenshot from the first State of Grid Repair panel that Leah Dawson Mooney presented at back in 2009 or 2009, I think. And the upper picture is actually, we took some era stimulus money and rebuilt our Dearborn subway. That's our basically blue line subway in downtown Chicago, for those familiar with the stimulus money, $100-some million project. And then MAP 21 was enacted. I mentioned some advocacy, especially by the larger rail agencies. They created a state of grid repair program that was mostly the rail side, a little bit BRT, and increased funding from $1.66 billion a year to $2.1 billion a year. And then again, as I mentioned earlier, they had the transit asset management requirements. And the FTA had to define state of grid repair. Easy to do, right? Well, maybe not so. There's a lot of discussion about what defines state of good repair. And in case you're wondering about the picture, this is one of my favorite pictures. That's President Obama signing the MAP 21. I think it was tied in with some other, as Congress does, tied in with the education bill. That's why Arne Duncan's in the back. But if you notice, John Mica, the then chairman of the House Transportation Committee, is hiding behind some other folks because he was in a tight reelection race and didn't want to be seen photographed next to the president. He laughs about it if you ever reach out to him. For anyone from his district, I apologize. But I apologize to him when I once showed this at a conference he was at. He had a good laugh about it, though. He has a good sense of humor. And then in the FAST Act, they increased funding for state of grid repair for the rail agencies again. to $2.5 billion a year. Dorval Carter in the last panel mentioned how CTA's formula funding has risen from $230 million a year to $290 million a year. That is entirely because of the increase in the 5337 State of Good Repair Program. Mm-hmm. As most people know, with formula funding, the urbanized formula funding was relatively flat, and if you're not growing, your portion of the share is going to decrease, but the increase in rail funding has really, really helped. I'm going to talk a little bit about the CTA overview. If you're not familiar with CTA, then come to Chicago, give me a call. I'll be happy to take you around. As my president Dorval mentioned last plenary session, $5 billion not, that has been begun or completed since 2011. I love this picture. It's for those familiar, that's the old merchandise mart. That's the brown and purple lines coming south to the merchandise mart. That's work that was done this past fall. And the reason I have this picture up is because once we were done with this project, we reduced our slow zones to under 6%, to 5.5%, which is the lowest it's been in over 15 years. So that was a great accomplishment for us, and we're keeping it that way. And I have nothing to do with that. My chief infrastructure officer, Chris Bouchel, and others, I guess maybe I helped with trying to advocate for money in the past, but they do a great job of taking the money and putting it where it's needed most. I know you can't read this picture, but if you're really interested in seeing it, go to our website. We actually are very transparent. Not only do we put up our ridership data, we put up our slow zone data. And if you had a microscope out a little, you got really close down, you could find that it says 5.5% as far as the percent of track that is in slow zone. 5.5% for an agency as big as CTA's, that's pretty good, because we at times have been well above 10, 12%. In fact, when Mayor Emanuel came in, we were at 10.9%, and now we're at between 5 and 5% of we're tracking slow zones. But I don't know if other agencies do that, but on our website, it lags about a month or so, but if you go under performance, there is a link for the slow zone map. These are just example of capital projects. I think a lot of people associate me with the core capacity project, Red Purple Modernization on the north side. Most importantly, the State of Good Repair. People might be familiar with our line cut we did for 5 months on the Red Line South from 18th and 95th Street. We shut the line down for 5 months. And in fact, the FTA took notice and they said maybe some other agencies should do that. And now look what WMATA is doing, others are doing. But it wasn't easy. But we had a bus bridge with well over 100 buses and brought people up to a green line that was, luckily we had a parallel line once you got up to about 63rd and 55th Street that helped move people up into the city. I talked before about buses and a rail fleet. We just finalized the deal for up to 846 rail cars. And our bus fleet, we're diversifying. We already have a couple electric buses that have gone through a lot of R&D for the past few years, and we're going to put out another, we announced we're putting out another procurement for 20 to 30 more for electric buses soon. The RTA has been a valuable associate of ours, they're basically Regional Transportation Authority for the overseas CTA. I see some friends from Metra here. John Milano, thanks for coming. And PACE. This is a couple years old, but this shows our State of Good Repair backlog. This is also on RTA's website, again, very transparent in Chicago. And you can see the CTA $13 billion State of Good Repair backlog. It does break it down into bus and rail and the shared. This is a history of transit asset management at CTA. I'm going to go through this. I'm actually not going to talk about this much because if you have questions, I probably won't be able to answer it. So you can go to the FTA State of Good Repair Roundtable, I think next month. That is Chris Bouchel and Bill Mooney Jr. walking on the tracks. If anyone knows those folks and involved in State of Good Repair, they are two wonderfully intelligent human beings. And I know they've helped out other transit agencies with their needs over the past few years. So with that, I think it's a good time to turn it over.
Okay. Thank you, Michael.
Okay, thanks for coming. And who could have guessed that right before your session, you heard from, four major leaders of transit systems in the country all talk about how serious this problem is. I mean, I give APT the credit for planning. Maybe it was Diane that planned the lunch topic right before this topic. So It was great to hear some real-life stories about what's going on around the country. I mean, we hear them every now and then, but it's really good to hear it from the heads of those agencies. So I'm going to talk a little bit about where we are on our State of Good Repair rule, and I'm also going to talk a little bit about what we're going to do once the rule is published. And I wish I could talk about the final rule, but the final rule isn't final yet because it's still being reviewed at the Office of Management and Budget. So what I'm going to talk about a little bit is what we published in the proposed rule, which came out last fall. And so if you attended the annual meeting in San Francisco in the fall, some of this will be repetitive, but for those who didn't, it would be maybe new information. So I'm going to start with sort of the problem that Mike teed up, which is this is the number that we've been using since our 2013 Conditions and Performance Report, which we sent to Congress every 2 years, came out. It's $86 billion national backlog, which continues to grow. There's a lot on this table, so what I'm going to do is point to three boxes. The first box on the left is the current annual investment in State of Good Repair of $10.3 billion a year. The second box to its right is what it would cost to maintain the backlog at $86 billion a year. So we would have to spend $2.4 billion more than we currently spend just to keep the backlog from getting larger. If we wanted to eliminate the backlog over a 30-year period, we actually would have to spend $8.2 billion more a year, which is $18.5 billion. So that is the sort of extent of the backlog, and what we do and how we do it and when we take action makes a difference in how big the backlog will be. On the point that Mike raised about buses, in the study that we put out when the backlog was only $78 billion in 2011, so it's grown 10% from $78 billion to $86. 40% of buses in our study were in marginal or poor condition. So it isn't all about rail, though rail is the largest part of the backlog. It does include the status of where buses are. Next slide is, what is transit asset management? Okay, so this is a simple definition that says it's a business model that uses the condition of assets to guide the optimal prioritization of funding at transit properties in order to keep our transit networks in a state of good repair. So if anyone wanted to know what is transit asset management, and there are a lot of ways to explain it, this is what we thought was the simplest way to be able to say what we think it is. So the next slide is follows up on what happened in MAP 21. As Mike said, there was this rail modernization study, a $50 billion backlog. We talked about not only the need for funding, but we talked about the need for an asset management system. So in section 5326 of MAP 21, Congress wrote a brand new section. And they asked us to do five things. They asked us to define the term state of good repair. They asked us to describe transit asset management plans that all recipients and sub-recipients of FTA aid would have to have a plan. It established performance. They asked us to establish performance measures. They asked us to collect data more than we collect now. And they also told us we had to provide technical assistance, which I'm going to talk about at the end, because we're not going to leave the bride at the altar when the final rule comes out. We're going to help you get through the implementation of the rule as best we can. So we defined state of good repair in the NPRM. And you know, when we published our ANPRM, which is from September 2013, we got 2,500 pages of comments. That's what took you so long to go from the ANPRM to the NPRM. But one of the common themes in almost all the comments that we got was, please keep it simple, FTA. Please not make us have to hire a PhD in order to implement your rule. So the definition that we came up with, we thought was pretty simple. The condition in which a capital asset is able to operate At a full level of performance, this means the asset is able to perform its design function, does not pose a known unacceptable safety risk, and its life cycle investments have been met or recovered. So that's what we published in the NPRM. We didn't get a lot of comments on it because I think when we published it, we followed what most of the comments were. So that's what we used when we published it last fall. And the next slide talks about the applicability of TAM plans. So again, in the NPRM, the law said all transit providers who are recipients or sub-recipients of FTA financial assistance must have a TAM plan. And so we said, well, okay, well, we can't treat everybody the same, because one of the comments was, it can't be a one-size-fits-all. What Mike's system is, which is much larger than a lot of other systems in the country, so we created a tier one and a tier two. And so the tier one is defined as you either operate rail or you have over 100 vehicles in peak revenue service. If you're not tier one, then you're tier two, which means you don't operate rail and you have less than 100 vehicles, or you exclusively receive federal funds from the 5310 or the 5311 program. So those are, 5310 is a program of $263 million that provides funding for seniors and individuals with disabilities. And 5311 is also known as the Rural Formula Funding Program, and that's about $553 million a year. So the next slide talks about what is it that we need to include in a TAM plan. And so we came up with 9 elements, which we've published in a guidebook last year that identifies what you need to include. And again, it's based on whether you're tier one or tier two. If you're tier one and you're tier two, you have to provide in your plan an inventory of your capital assets. You have to have a condition assessment. You have to use some decision support tools. And you have to prioritize your investments. Okay, everybody has to do that. If you're only tier one, which again are the larger systems, then you have to do 5 other things. You have to have a transit asset management and state of good repair policy in your plan. You have to have an implementation strategy. You have to have a list of key annual activities. You have to have an identification of all of your funding, and you have to have an evaluation plan. So if you're tier one, you do all 9. If you're tier two, you do 1 through 4. And again, we looked at this as, again, the comments were, please don't treat a small bus operator like you treat CTA, okay? And we said, yeah, that makes sense. CTA has a lot more assets than a small bus operator. It's not fair to ask you to do a lot more work just because you're small. Who owns the TAM plan? So we had a big discussion about it, and we came up with a term called the accountable executive. This is also a term that's used in a lot of the safety rules that have come out. And the accountable executive will probably be the GM, though it could be the executive director of the agency, if that's really the equivalent of the GM. And essentially, it was to have a person who is accountable for the TAM plan. The coordination of the plan is every tier one provider must develop its own TAM plan. So if you're one of the big systems, you have to have your own plan. If you're a tier two provider, and we defined that in the previous slides, then you can either do your own plan or you could opt out and participate in a group plan. And a group plan would be offered by either the state in which you live or a designated recipient. And the group plan participant, whoever, if you decide to do a group plan, you must collaborate with the sponsor of the plan in the development of the plan. So you don't wipe your hands of it and just say, well, the state will do my plan. You actually need to work with the state so the state includes the information that they need in order to do a group plan. So that, again, was to address the let's not treat everybody with the same one-size-fits-all approach. The time frames for getting the plan done, it's 2 years after the effective date, and the effective date is the date that we publish the final rule, which we hope will be next month. We're this close, and I say this close. I'm very optimistic that, you know, you can use the lights at the end of the tunnel, you're down the home stretch and you see that, you know, all those things, all those analogies, we are that close that we will publish next month, which we look forward to doing that. You must update the plan every 4 years, and the 4 year time frame was to coincide with the STIP. And if you had a significant change in your plan, and the most common thing that we can think of is a natural disaster, a Hurricane Sandy, a Hurricane Katrina, serious flooding, which sort of creates problems, you know, your assets maybe have all been damaged or some of them have been damaged or destroyed, and so you would have to update the plan if that was to happen. We're going to talk about performance metrics next. So the law says FTA will set the measure, but each transit provider will establish his or her own target. And just so you know, if you set a target and you exceed your target, you don't get any more money from FTA. However, if you set a target and you don't meet your target, we don't penalize you and take any of your funding away. That's in the law. So the four areas of performance metrics were rolling stock, which would include all types of rolling stock, facilities, which would include all types, infrastructure, which would include rail, track, guideway, signals, and systems, and equipment, which would be non-revenue vehicles. So again, from the NPRM, that's not new, but those would be the measures. For rolling stock, it would be the percent of vehicles that have met or exceeded their useful life benchmark. So that's an age-based approach. In the ANPRM, we offered four options on how to do performance measures. One was age-based, one was condition-based, one was performance-based, and the fourth option was sort of a hybrid of all three. So in the NPRM, we picked three of the four ways that you could do it, and one is age-based. Two are age-based, rolling stock and equipment. Facilities is condition-based, which would be the percent of facilities with a condition rating below 3 on the FTA term scale. Term is the transit economic requirements model, which we've been using for over a decade, with 5 being in excellent condition and 1 being poor. And for infrastructure, it would be a performance-based metric, which would be the percent of guideway directional route miles with performance restrictions by class. Mike talked about track with slow zones. And then the fourth one, again, would be an age base, which would be the percent of revenue vehicles within a particular asset class that have met or exceeded their useful life benchmark. I'm going to skip the benchmark slide. So annual targets are set for each asset class. So if you have bus and rail, you have to set a target for your bus assets and a target for your rail ones. All of your measures should be supported by data and also include reasonable financial projections, and we leave that up to you. Targets for group plans, if you happen to be a Tier 2 provider and you met the Tier 2 requirement, the targets for the group plan apply to the group as a whole. And the targets and your condition assessments would be reported annually to FTA using the National Transit Database, which most people use right now for a lot of data that you report to us already. The certification of the TAM plan, it's self-certified by the accountable executive. You don't need to send your plan to the FTA regional office. And if you do, they'll send it back. Now, actually, we don't have the staff to review every single plan. We're probably talking about 1,500 plans, probably, based on our estimates. FTA will update our certifications and assurances to reflect the TAM plan requirements. Everyone knows what certs and assurances are. And we will review the plans and the progress during triennial reviews, which are done every 3 years, and state management reviews, as well as during MPO certification reviews. So that is our method of looking at the plans to, one, see if you have one, two, if it's signed by someone who's your accountable executive, and three, whether it has all the elements that we talked about earlier. The next slide is actually just to show you that there is a nexus between public transportation safety and all of the requirements that were in MAP 21 that relate to that, the transit asset management requirements that I'm referring to, and the transportation planning process. And I won't go through the whole chart, but I just wanted you to know they're not separate silos. They may be administered or they look that way, but there's a lot of nexus and interconnectivity between them. So I just wanted to put that up there just so you know. We didn't develop these in a silo, even though sometimes it appears that that's what we do. So like I said, how can FTA help you after the rule's been made final? And we're all in on trying to make this as simple as it can. We do want everybody to comply. And we know that for some it'll be easy and for others it may be hard. So we've been doing a lot of work since 2010 on a lot of different guidebooks. And there's a list of things that we're working on. Some we've already put up on our website, which is down there at the bottom. The Small Providers Guide, which is our most recent publication, is for small providers, and it includes the template to do the TAM plan. So you don't even have to, if you don't want to, hire anybody to help you do a TAM plan. You can take the template right out of the guide, and you can use that. And that is available on our website. We are working on performance measures guidebooks to help you with performance measurements. We know it's not simple, but we're also providing a facility condition assessment workbook or guidebook, and one that helps measure slow zones. So we're going to help you if you have slow zones and you don't know how to measure them. We're going to help you. We're also going to help you with how to do targets, how to calculate a target. And we're going to publish those guidebooks when we publish the final rule, hopefully next month. And because we don't know it all, we're going to give you 60 days to offer your comments to see if we've missed anything. Because, there's no monopoly on how to do this. And so we think that we have good contractors that have been helping us. We've listened to the industry, but we're going to put these guidebooks out, and we're going to give you 60 days to comment on it to help us to help make sure that we didn't miss something important. We've got a newsletter, TAM News News, which will be available if you want it to go to our Gov delivery list, which you can sign up for alerts on our webpage. We're going to publish one in the summer that will focus on MBTA's decision support tool, which they've used quite well in helping them do their TAM plan. Training courses, National Transit Institute, they have a booth right out here. We give them $5 million a year. They're going to help us. They're going to do a TAM 101 course, and they're going to align it with the final rule, and it'll be available in the fall of 2016, just as the final rule comes out. They're going to help us with some training courses to help with the guidebook methodologies. That'll be available in the fall. And they're also going to do a TAM 201 implementation course for those of you who have the basics but want to learn a little bit more. And that'll be available a year from this fall. So we're going to use them, and hopefully you will use them as well. As Mike said, we have a roundtable in Minneapolis on July 13th. It's held in conjunction with the TRB Asset Management Conference, which is also in Minneapolis. We've identified up to 60 transit stakeholders. We're going to do sort of a peer exchange, so it's not going to be FTA dominating the workshop. It's going to be a lot of discussion among your peers. And if you want to go to it, there's an email address at the bottom of the slide, and it's really going to be first come, first serve as far as how many people we can accept. But it will be July 13th in Minneapolis, and it's only one day. Finally, reaching out to the industry when the rule is published. We plan to have a webinar series. We plan to do four of them on the final rule. Two of them will be for small providers. We're going to do two of them on the NTD asset inventory, and we're going to do two on the performance measures guidebook to walk you through them just in case they're not self-explanatory. And we're going to go to as many conferences as we can and do what we can to make sure everyone understands the final rules and how you can be successful. So with that, thank you very much.
All right, thank you. Good to know, helps on the way.
Helps on the way.
Helps on the way. And Mike, take it away on data and decision making.
All right, thank you.
Here.
All right, this presentation is going to be a little more technical. The key presentation takeaways are going to be data is a means to an end. That end is fact-based decision making, and the truth is in the data. Don't change the data to fit your narrative. So what's the topic?
Never happens.
Never happens. So you hear these buzzwords, big data, predictive analytics, business intelligence, data warehousing. This is how to integrate that into your asset management program. So the first question is, what is good data? It's been vetted, it's been collected using proper methodology, it can be easily accessed and processed, and free data can be better than paid data. So take a few seconds to study this chart. It pretty clearly demonstrates the difference between precision and accuracy. One thing to remember with high precision and high accuracy data is that it can be incredibly expensive. For your needs, you may not need the most precise data. For example, if you're trying to find hotspots on an electrical or catenary system, you would need to just understand relative heat instead of absolute heat. On the other hand, a financial analysis of a minor project is not going to suffice if you know that it's going to cost within a $10 million band. This chart is monthly boarding averages at RTD from 2000 to 2014. Well, it looks like we have great swings in ridership from month to month. There are actually only two dates that are concerning. These are the values that are outside of the control limits. These control limits are derived from the data you see on the chart. The values that are concerning are specifically October and December. Assuming that these control limits are developed using statistical methods rather than seat of the pants methods, these anomalies should be explainable and attributable to an outside influence. The particular control limits on this chart use a 95% confidence bound. What that means in layman's terms is that there's only a 5% probability that these values are due to chance rather than being explainable. Something about proper methodology is that an indicator is useless without understanding what you're measuring. It's important for everyone to have an underlying understanding of what's being measured. If I tell you that car A has a fuel tank that's half full and car B has a fuel tank that's three quarters full, you don't have enough information to decide anything. If I tell you that car A gets 16 miles per gallon and car B is getting 12 miles per gallon, then we're starting to get somewhere. Finally, I tell you that they both have 20-gallon tanks. We now know that car A can go 160 miles and car B can go 180 miles. For something like measuring ridership, you need a properly developed sampling plan. You can't just haphazardly throw APCs on some of your trains. The APCs are sending a signal like the sensor in your fuel tank, and the sampling plan lets you know the shape and size of the tank. Averages hide things. We have two cities. One's got an average temperature of 65, and the other has an average temperature of 70. So we want to know if we should pack a coat. Turns out one of the cities is San Diego and the other city is Denver. So we need more information to understand what the average is really saying. The averages hide the outliers in the Denver example. It could be 100 degrees or it could be zero. And without some other piece of information, such as the date, we have no way to know how to pack. The point here isn't to say that you should use an average. It's to make sure that you're understanding how you're interpreting the data and that it's done correctly and not in a way that's unintentionally misleading to your decision makers. Some of the applications of data are live data streams, business decision making, operational decision making, and performance reporting and monitoring. To the right is a screenshot of weather in Denver. What's cool about the weather, you're wondering? This is on a display so that our State of Good Repair inspectors can make a go, no-go decision for flying a UAV for aerial inspections without needing to look up each piece of information individual. It is important because having it in one place saves a significant amount of time when these guys would have to go look it up in different places. So the next step in making this actionable to decision makers would be displaying a lantern. What I mean by this is a light that's green if everything's okay and red if any individual parameter is outside of bounds. So we've decided that we want data. What are the next steps? First, we have to collect it. Then we must aggregate it in a meaningful way. After it's aggregated, it needs to be audited to make sure there's not an error in methodology or data entry. Finally, it must be open and accessible to those who would benefit from it. Part of making data accessible to everyone is that there may be a benefit from using your data to a group that you've never realized. Rather than making information available on an opt-in basis, it's better to make it available to all within the organization and maybe even the public, assuming that your regulatory environment permits it. It's important to provide context to that open data so that it cannot be misrepresented unintentionally or misused for a political purpose. So another application of this data that we're actually doing at RTD in purchasing decisions is lifecycle cost management. We can justify upfront capital expenses to save money on the back end in terms that our budget departments will respond to. In this example, we have a train for manufacturer one and a train for manufacturer two. Through historical analysis of actual data from our enterprise asset management software, we can see what it costs to maintain each of these trains. With manufacturer one, we start with $300,000 in the red relative to manufacturer two. We can turn these figures into dollar per mile figures using data from our ridership systems, and we compare them with usage estimates from planning and get estimated lifecycle O&M costs. The next step is to analyze which is the more financially sound purchase. Turns out that buying the more expensive train breaks even in 20 years and saves an additional $300,000 over the life cycle of each vehicle. Another is maintenance interval analysis. You may be aware that RTD outfitted several of our light rail traction motor gearboxes with accelerometers to capture vibration telemetry. The goal of this project was to see if we were prematurely rebuilding gearboxes. As we had never suffered a failure, this was a reasonable question. After this data was collected, aggregated, and analyzed, it was determined that there was not significant risk of failure if we push back the rebuild interval. What does that have to do with big data, you may be asking? This project required an initial $300,000 investment. It's a pretty hefty price tag for the exploration of a question. After all, data can be pretty expensive. Turns out it reduced our backlog by the amounts you see in the graph on screen, and hard dollar savings were around $32 million over the life cycles of our LRV fleet. This is actual data from that gearbox project, snapshotted from a live from a single point in time. Right now, it's not particularly valuable for decision making, though it does shed some insight into the current state of gearbox. The problem here is that we don't understand context. There may be a temptation to analyze this from one of you who knows about vibration analysis. What we don't know is whether the LRV is in a station, on a bridge, accelerating, at full load, empty, or any number of other things that may influence these readings. This is why it's important to always have context surrounding your data so that it does not lead someone astray. This data is only valuable from a monetary standpoint once it's aggregated, audited, and then analyzed. Part of that analysis involves correcting for everything I just mentioned and segregating and classifying observations based on parameters that might influence vibration patterns. Another application is predicting future expenses. This is a graph that shows actual kilowatt hour per mile figures for some of our light rail subfleets. It's interesting, but not particularly valuable from a business standpoint until we look at how it can be applied. Some of the potential applications are analyzing the cost of service changes and assisting in environmental impact studies. Another example of this being useful to an outside group could be for your marketing efforts. If part of your strategy involves being green, you can use this information in promotional materials. This is data that originates out of rail ops, has financial value to the budget department, and has an intangible benefit to marketing efforts. This particular graph is sample data where observations outside of one standard deviation are automatically marked and highlighted for easy recognition. Our primary BI platform, Oracle Business Intelligence, allows for automated emails to be sent out whenever something happens outside of predetermined limits. This is a powerful tool as it allows members to know about issues the moment they arise rather than have to log into the dashboard and find out after the fact. In summary, you need to use proper methods in your data collection, audit your data for accuracy, make it accessible with context, and utilize automated reporting when it's beneficial. If you have questions, here's my contact info.
Well, thank you, Mike, for leading this meeting. Next, we'll hear from Bernadette and the importance of boundary and title determinations. Here, click on yourself.
Not a data or a technical person. Well, I'll just get started real quick while you set that up. Going deeper into the weeds of project delivery here, dealing with the real estate aspect, are there any real estate people in the audience by any chance? Doesn't surprise me. I was part of BART's maintenance and engineering department during the development of its asset management program. And one of the things that became clear to me is that whereas large capital projects deal with right-of-way issues as a routine matter, many of the maintenance and engineering folks really didn't think of right-of-way as an issue because they felt that they were dealing with existing assets within existing rights-of-way. What I want to review with you today very quickly and very briefly is just do a survey of some of the issues that can arise when trying to do work on an existing right-of-way with new, say, asset management projects, capital projects, that don't really fit into the routine activities, and your existing right-of-way might not support those activities. Some of the issues dealing with failing to secure those adequate property rights, what are some solutions, and of course, don't try this on your own. This is like the race car driver driving down the street, not to be done at home. Really consult an expert, because it'll take a right-of-way expert to really tell you what your title is. I'm going to start with some of the problems that could occur if you fail to secure your adequate property rights. Of course, there's always construction delays, and those will come up if you're in the middle of construction. And a property owner says, hey, you're on my property. And it could be another public agency, which is often the case. Many public agencies don't realize that they're crossing a water district canal or something, and they should have acquired the rights to do that. Inverse condemnation is an issue if you're dealing with a private property owner. They could sue the district or sue your agency for not having acquired the rights and for being on their property without permission. There's also loss of goodwill in the community if you're out there and the community feels that you're strong-arming them. And something I forgot to put on the slide is that you could lose your funding. Depending upon the funding source, there are procedures for acquiring rights of way and dealing with right-of-way issues on your project. So be aware, there is a potential for losing funding as well. All of this translates into delay, which translates into costs. With hopefully what I'm going to show you today, a little upfront research by your real estate department during your design process, no time lost, can save you a lot of time potentially on the back end during your project. So I'm going to run through 10 very quickly, just some issues that might come up during a capital project. This shows a BART right-of-way here. The project in this case was retrofitting the foundations underneath our aerial structures. And it turned out because of the equipment being used, we needed just 10 feet on either side of our right-of-way for access and maneuvering the equipment around that. So you don't want to be trespassing on somebody's property with your equipment as you work around your right-of-way. At the same location, which is actually a more complicated than most, the second issue is access rights. So again, depending upon the equipment you're being used, the route you're taking, the size of the project, your routine access routes might not be sufficient. In this case, I gave you a really complicated one. This is going through a Union Pacific yard, so we had to get in between all of the yard leads, and it became very complicated getting access there. But again, don't forget about access needs. In this case, sometimes the boundaries, property boundaries, might not be obvious. The red lines here show what the as-built environment is, but in fact, the of-record title is what's shown in blue. And this represents public streets. BART has a statutory right to construct and do work in public streets. So normally we would just enforce that and not acquire new property rights. But in this case, not only were the rights not really clear between the red and the blue lines there, but BART early on during the building of the system had acquired an easement from Union Pacific Railroad, actually it was Southern Pacific at the time, and had actually signed a contract saying, or an easement saying, that it would agree to talk to the railroad before doing any work within that blue shaded area. So even though on paper we thought we had the rights, we have the right to work within public streets, a little more examination said, oh, no, Union Pacific still owns that right-of-way, and we have an easement deed that restricts our ability to do certain work, which I'm going to highlight later in the presentation. In some cases, again, not really obvious. There's three levels of rights going on here. The green arrow shows work within a public street. It's labeled an easement, joint use area. But that's an area that's within a public street, so we would assert our statutory rights. The second area we were able to acquire in fee. Again, this is part of a railroad right-of-way. And the railroad was comfortable in conveying fee interest to BART, which gives us pretty much the right to do what we want to do. But in the third case, you see the blue area is with an easement from the railroad. So again, that easement came with restricted rights. And you see by the shaded line above that, we additionally had to acquire some rights for our project. So again, the rights may vary within and may not be obvious by the constructed environment what the rights are. In this case, there was deed error in acquiring the right-of-way. I'm going to see if I can highlight this. This is the area in question. This location, and this is our original right-of-way map, you can see it's noted as a temporary construction easement. Well, somehow during the, during construction and during the finalization of the permanent easement, the foundation for this column was built within that little red area, and we did not reflect it in the deed. So BART had its foundation outside of its existing right-of-way. When we came in and did the work, we ended up acquiring a temporary easement area here, but also going back in and cleaning up that right and acquiring the permanent rights for that foundation as it was expanded for the project. In this case, our rights disappeared completely. Our original right-of-way map here shows an access route along Trapani Avenue to our right-of-way. And sometime, I forget the date, sometime in the future, the city then, this is a assessor's parcel map, the city abandoned the road and it reverted to the adjacent property owners, and only a small portion was conveyed to BART or reserved for BART. So when we had to do a project, we later had to acquire rights over property that we thought we originally had the rights of access to. We had to acquire those rights for that project. Aside from boundaries and all of that, there are also agreement restrictions. I mentioned earlier about the Union Pacific deed that restricted BART's ability to do work. So item one there is the example language from that deed. It says after initial construction, BART shall not change or modify the aerial structure without express written approval of the railroad. So even if we didn't need that additional temporary access construction easement along the side, nonetheless, we would have had to go back to the railroad before doing any work on our own structure within our own right-of-way. Another example, this is an agreement, a joint use agreement with Caltrans. And in this project, BART was retrofitting the station agent break room within our station, and it wanted to place a trailer as a temporary break room within another portion of the right-of-way. And examination of the right-of-way there showed that the right-of-way was restricted to pedestrian access only. So we had to go back to Caltrans and get a permit to put that trailer within that right-of-way. That was an easy fix. It only took, I think, about 6 weeks to get that permit. It wasn't a problem. If we had put the trailer out there without permission ahead of time, it could have been a bit of a problem, both, again, goodwill with Caltrans, maybe delay in having to remove the trailer and put it back in. So that one worked out well. There are also legal or statutory restrictions to be aware of. Are most of you aware of the 4F restrictions as part of the statute? The Secretary of Transportation may approve a transportation program, so this is tied to funding, requiring the use of publicly owned land of a public park and recreation area only if there is no prudent and feasible alternative. That includes land that the agency owns and a park use that the agency has permitted. So in the case that this kind of came back to haunt Bart was underneath our aerial structure, we own the land in fee. We had permitted a local city to put a greenway underneath our aerial structure, but we didn't word the agreement properly. And there's proper wording you can do to protect yourself, essentially preserving that use for transportation purposes. And because of that, we had to go through the full environmental process, full evidence and work with the cities to get an agreement from each of the cities saying that there's not any harm or we're gonna minimize the harm, and we had to replace all of the landscaping and everything that had been there. So that one actually didn't work out so well. When we went back after the project, we'd cleaned that up and got all our agreements, the right wording in there that would allow us to do work without this problem. Other things, again, many of you may be aware of, AASHTO regs require that passing over a railroad has to be in accordance with the railroad's procedures, so just be aware of that as well. This is also tied to the potential loss of fundings. FHWA money in particular requires a right-of-way certification. Part of that right-of-way certification, prior to advertising the contract for bid, requires that there's a special coordination with railroads. So if you haven't done that coordination with the railroads, not necessarily related to title, but it is part of the acquisition process, part of the funding process, that you have to coordinate with the railroads in particular. So a good thing to be aware of. Just a reminder that property rights are aerial as well as subsurface. So back to that original slide where I showed that 10-foot right-of-way where we needed just some maneuvering for equipment. Even if your equipment is within your right-of-way, if you have a boom that's coming around and to get up to your aerial structure and that boom crosses the right-of-way line, you're now on someone else's property and need to acquire those rights. Thinking from a right-of-way perspective, railroad perspective, that's the same as fouling the tracks. Somebody has a boom and they're on their own property within their own space, but they could tip over. You want to be aware of that. Same thing. In this case, it was some battered piles that were going to pass across the right-of-way line. I think this is the right-of-way line here. It's marked. So that's the right-of-way line, and you can see the piles that were going to extend beyond it subsurface. So we acquired the rights for those. Last case, don't forget sometimes there are third-party rights within the right-of-way, particularly with our aerial structure. BART leases many locations out to property owners, a lot of times for parking or other things under our equipment. It's nice little revenue generating. But in this case, this was actually an unauthorized encroachment. This is a refrigeration unit serving a grocery store right next door. Both a little bit of title research and look into it, we were able to determine that they were not there with permission. This was sitting right on top of the foundation for our column that we needed to retrofit, and we just worked closely with the grocery store to have them relocate it at their own expense and put it on the roof. Of course, if they had been there with permission, there would have been official relocation rules and things and cost to the project if BART had had to do that work. So be aware of third-party rights as well. I'm going really fast because I know we're stressed for time. 1 minute I've got. So we're now into solving our problems. We can prove priority of rights. In this case, BART acquired its right-of-way crossing a state highway from the railroad that predated construction of the highway. So BART had priority of rights over the highway. That was a hard lesson for the highway to accept. I talked about our statutory authority. Not only in the BART Act, but also in the Code of Civil Procedure. If you're getting out there to do surveys, We're allowed to do that, even soil borings and things like that that are minorly invasive. We have statutory authority to do that. And another solution is to just work around the problem. In this case, again, the foundation's issues, they cut off the foundation just to avoid that other right-of-way. You can see this was a major water line that they just didn't want to relocate or mess with. And of course, acquire the rights that you need. So if you want to talk to an expert and try to get around it, there's ways to get around it, but there's always acquire the rights you need, and better sooner rather than later. So in conclusion, again, don't try this on your own. I've only shown you the easy ones. There's much more complicated and more interesting to me, and unfortunately there aren't more real estate people out there in the audience. But understand the project scope, understand the boundaries and relationship to other people's property rights, understand what your entitlements are because you can enforce those, and then take whatever the appropriate action is. So thank you.
All right. Performance management.
Yeah.
Just making sense of all of this.
Yeah, I have a quick 45 slides, so. my takeaways, asset management is a tool, and we want to try to get in there before problems arise that cause failure. In our case, failure is not performing as designed, right? You're not on time. Rider, or, you know, your trains aren't on time, your buses aren't on time, they're not running. Performance metrics give you a snapshot as you're going along. It's a tool for me and our leadership to look at that and see how we're doing quickly, and it doesn't get into the detail of big data. And it should be an integrated part. We try to make it part of our everyday activities for our crews. We have our asset management team is two people, and we push that down to the facilities maintenance and the people who are actually doing the work. We give them the tools so that they can do the measurements themselves. Again, it's trying to find those problems before failures occur. Firefighting is great. It's exciting. You get to go out there and save the day and get things running again. Fire prevention is a lot more enjoyable for our riders. Did I go the wrong way? Nope. Okay, performance metrics, again, a snapshot. Everybody's familiar with miles between failure and other similar metrics. We've developed some that are specific to our asset management needs. Just trying to chart that the testing and measurement is taking place. So maintenance away, their inspection chart. What's expected of the crews every month and how are they performing against that? Again, our bridge requirements, our bridge inspections, we have other regulations that require annual bridge inspections. So are those taking place in time? The crews are looking at, okay, in the winter or in the spring runoff, I can't be over the rivers and streams, but I could be doing the bridges over the roads. So help them prioritize their work and make sure they're managing that in a way that they can get their work done. You start looking at what are the failures, where are the interruptions, service interruptions happening, and you can use that to focus on where you need to put your resources to make things happen. So you can see other is a big problem for us, which is hard to manage, but certainly vehicle-related or MOW-related, those are things we can do. But the others we need to look at from a safety standpoint, and we feel like safety has a major role in influencing what's on our asset management state of good repair list. That has as much input to our system as some of the measurements out on the line. And then, as Bob mentioned, the monthly rating we use right now is 0 to 10 scale. We're going to have to do some severe mathematics to convert this to a 0 to 5 scale. We've got a team working on that right now, trying to come up with an algorithm to
PhD
make that happen.
Statistics.
So an example of performance or analysis or lack of performance analysis, we had excessive heat in the signal bungalow, and the firefighters got out there and they said, well, let's put not just one, let's put two air conditioning units in that bungalow. I started looking at that and I go, well, you know, Utah's kind of warm. Next to Nevada, I go down and see bungalows in UP has in Nevada, and they don't have air conditioning units in there. we didn't quite understand what the problem was. So a little more investigation, if we'd done our work and we'd managed our system, we'd probably clean the air filters every once in a while. So we could have spent $10 instead of $800 on the problem. It was a great lesson learned. It was a great opportunity to, you know, to talk to people about, let's do the right things at the right time and make sure we're doing the right things. Let's, you know, grind the track when we need to grind it. You know, inspect those switches, test the switch heaters before winter comes, things like that. But pretty simple one here, pretty telling for us. So as you're looking at your asset management program, look to your needs. What is your system? What's your climate? What are the issues that affect you and could have the most impact on your service and the reliability of your system? The staff who operate and maintain that system must be involved and see the benefits. They're measuring things and they're not getting any feedback. They're not seeing where they're seeing problems and they don't see that you and part of your capital programming process aren't generating a project from that. They're going to lose interest in participating in that. And so, again, we try to make it an active part of what we do. We're out there inspecting. We've created systems on tablets and even on smartphones so they can do a lot of this inventory there. And if they do see a problem, it has an ability to tap on and write comments, and that goes to the supervisor and can create work orders for that. And then we want to look at metrics that perform at a high level, and then where needed, get into the details. So these are the people that actually do the work, and if you need to talk about our system here, it's interesting, ours evolved from a bus or a bridge inspection software that Bentley had developed, and working with them, they saw some interest and need in the industry to expand that, and they were great to work with to expand that basic software into an overall transit asset management program for us. There, I'm done.
Wow. Impressive. All right, so we've gone on our journey from sort of the big picture policy perspective down to implementation on a number of specific factors. Do we have any questions for our panelists? Greg.
One thing that just struck me was on assets that are actually on, say, for commuter rail, assets that are actually on by railroad, are management inspection issues just worked out in agreement between the two entities, or how is that handled?
I'm going to ask the Metro guy in the back of the room.
So for your inventory, if you, for example, if you go over a bridge that you don't own, but you use it, you would include it in your inventory, but if someone else is paying for the rehabilitation of the bridge, you wouldn't include it in your investment prioritization. So in doing the inventory, you would include it, but for purposes of doing, you know, how am I going to spend your money plus the FTA State of Good Repair Formula Fund, you wouldn't include it because you're not responsible for keeping it in a state of good repair, but you are using it.
So if we're running over Union Pacific right away, along with Metra on the right. West side of Chicago, but we're leasing it from UP.
Correct.
We list it, but it's their job to take care of it?
That's correct.
Okay. If you don't own it.
I think we have an add-on from the railroad perspective. Okay.
Right.
Yes, sir.
For Robert, I had a question. I'm with the Cleveland RTA, and we've been going through, and I noticed you split infrastructure and made it a performance rating rather than the 1 to 5 rating. And we've been going through merrily rating our tracks and stuff from 1 to 5.
Okay.
And I'm just curious why it's not the same as facilities.
So facilities was easy because you sort of, we thought it was easier for you to know when you built something, and you would record it. In the case of track, we wanted, well, I guess you could determine when you put track down, but we thought it was more of a performance-based metric. That was sort of the comments that we got when we published the A and PRM. So we tried to accommodate sort of everyone's concerns. Some folks wanted it all age-based, some folks wanted it all condition-based, some folks, very few people, wanted it all performance-based. So we tried to pick the ones that fit the most logical way of measuring something. And so for track, like slow zones, for example, Mike talked about slow zones. And so if you have slow zones, it would be, you know, sort of the percentage of track that are operated under a slow zone. He said it was 5.5% or something like that.
Yeah, exactly right.
And so that's how we thought it would make sense. So in the guidebooks that we're putting out, we will explain that in more detail for you.
Here's another example, overhead camera system.
Infrastructure.
It may very well perform every day, not at a reduced speed, but you have conditioned the components, the foundations, the structures are terrible.
Okay.
So again, we've been, in fact, we have an RPR right now, our consultant come and rate everything again from 1 to 5.
Okay. In the guidebooks that we're producing, that will give you sort of a detailed explanation of how to do that. So I would say for the guide, and that'll be in the guidebooks that we're going to publish when the final rule comes out. Since we're going to open it for a 60-day comment, why don't you include exactly what you just said about how to convert what you're now saying, sort of a age-based approach to a performance-based approach, and make sure that in the guidebook we have a way to be able to help you to do that. So please comment on the guidebooks.
We'll definitely make a comment.
Okay, thank you.
So unfortunately we are out of time, but I invite you to come up and talk to our panelists with any questions that you might have. And before we thank them, one thing is we have a transit performance management subcommittee, so you can go to MyAPTA and continue the conversation there. And I'd also like to acknowledge Mark Teschauer, who was our coordinator for this session and put it together. Thank you, Mark, for all your hard work, and thank you very much to our panelists.
Thank you.
Thanks, Anna. Thank you.